Thank you, Shruti. I'll just share my presentation. So from glaucoma, we'll be now going over to retina presentations. Thank you for extensively covering how Okta actually helps us with, managing non-invasive imaging of the disc and the retina. And I think Zia has already spoken about the basics of it. So I will be covering the superficial retinal diseases, primarily diabetic retinopathy and vein occlusion, and how Okta has actually helped us. I have no financial disclosures. So coming to the layers on the Okta, since Zia has already covered it overall, I'll go a little bit deeper into each one of the different layers. So now coming first to the superficial layer. Yeah, so it basically has a centripetal pattern around the FAZ. There is a continuous perifoveal arcade with regular meshes. The thickness is about 10 microns and the offset is 3 microns from the ILM. So the layers that you see here are the retinal nerve fiber layer, the ganglion cell layer, and the superficial inner plexiform layers is what is seen in the SCP. Going on to the DCP or the deep capillary layers, this has a more close-knit pattern of vessels distributed around the avascular zone. And it's about 60 microns. What you see here are the deep inner plexiform layer, the inner nuclear layer, outer plexiform, and the superficial outer nuclear layer. So here you're seeing a very close-knit pattern of the vessels. Then there's the outer retina. Here you normally don't see any vascular plexus. The offset is about 30 microns from the RP. Thickness is again 30 microns. And the layers that you see here are the deep outer nuclear to the external limiting layer. Here no vascular plexus is visible. And then finally, you have the choriocapillaris layer, which, as you can see here, covers the choriocapillaris and is about 60 microns from the RP, and it has a very coarse texture. Now, after these initial layers were described, they came up with another layer called as the middle capillary plexus or the intermediate capillary plexus, which lies between the superficial and the deep. You can see it kind of has the features of both the superficial and the deep. Now, if you look at the different sections that you see on Okta, you have a 3x3, 6x6, and an 8x8 scan. And this is how much of the field of view that you get. So that's one of the major limitations, that we're not actually able to image the periphery beyond the arcades using the Okta. But with montaging and higher scan areas, we are, getting there where we'll be able to eventually, I'm sure, image even the mid-periphery. So salient differences between Okta and FA, and why I'm saying this here in DR, is because we do depend a lot on these other two imaging modalities. With Okta, we have the single most important advantage that it can be acquired in a couple of seconds or minutes. Of course, patient cooperation is very important, but it can be done quickly. It does not require an intravenous injection, and drug allergies, anaphylaxis is avoided. And more importantly, it has a 3D nature, which means you can see each layer separately, which you can never do in a regular dye-based angiography, which comes to the advantages of dye-based is that you can actually see the dye leakage, which is an important hallmark for several vascular abnormalities because you want to see the neovascularizations, you want to see the microaneurysms. And major limitation is that it is two-dimensional. And also you cannot repeat it, every other visit that the patient comes in, it's difficult to do the dye-based angiography. So one advantage that I did not really mention in the comparison before is that you have a quantitative and qualitative analysis that can be done on these Okta images. A lot of these come inbuilt as an inbuilt software. This is the OctoView one, where you can actually look at the color-coded vascular density, and we also get it as an index, which means you can prognosticate, you can do a follow-up of these patients to see whether there is improvement or worsening of the disease. We are able to map objectively a flow area and a non-flow area. So objectivity is another important advantage, which is difficult in a dye-based angiography where, there's a lot of subjective analysis that goes into it. One reader would be very different from another. The angioanalytics tool also helps us to delineate membranes, and I think Dr. Santosh will be covering about that more in detail. And so this is how we get a color-coded map, the blue, the navy blue indicating where there is absence of flow. And you can see it's more diffuse, and the FAZ is very much altered compared to inpatients with diabetes compared to BRVOs or vein occlusions where the abnormalities are more localized. We also had an inbuilt software mate where we looked at fractal analysis. Our team put this together and I will share a couple of studies. Here, the blue again indicates non-flow areas and the red indicates the high flow areas or the vasculature. So coming specifically to diabetic retinopathy, it helps us in analysis of retinal vasculature, whether it is new blood vessels, the vascular density, the dropout in both the SCP and the DCP. The FAZ also we are able to see very early, and we are able to pick out macular ischemia, and the irregularity of the FAZ is very well seen. With respect to macular edema, we are able to see microaneurysms and capillary dropout areas very well. I'll show you in some images. So this is a patient which has an NVE, as you can see here on the fundus image, and the angiography is showing extensive leakage. But on the octa, we are able to describe the membrane. If you want, you can even map it out and quantify it to see response to treatment, be it with PRP or with anti-VEGF. Here again, a patient with NVD, you can see extensive leakage, but with the different segmentation that's possible with octa, you can see it at the optic nerve head level and even extending into the vitreous. This is another picture again of NVD at the vitreous level, at the nerve head, and at the peripapillary capillary level. So the segmentation is definitely very, very helpful, and you most often need to do it manually. The automated segmentation is also available. So this is the regressing NVD before and after PRP. If you can see in the panel above, the NVD is extensive, but post PRP you see it regressing. Now we are also able to see aneurysms at different levels, and especially with the macular edema, we are also able to see it at the DCP level. This is another patient where we were able to see the telangiectatic vessels at the foveal avascular zone in a patient with edema. And important is that patients, even without any edema, we are able to show that the FAZ was altered even before clinical changes appear. So that means we know that the pathology happens much, much earlier in the course of the disease, and it might actually help us in better interventions, be it systemic or local. These are vascular density maps like I showed you before, and you're able to see what is the whole image vessel density, or if you want to see quadrant wise or sector wise, also it's possible. Now coming a little bit into the on-fast image, that also shows us a lot of detail, and it's very well comparable to a dye-based angiography where we see that pattern and cystoid macular edema so beautifully. It can be seen both again in the superficial and the deep layers, and the corresponding on-fast also shows the edema. Now, comparing no macular edema with cystoid macular edema, we're able to see the manifestation across the different layers and in the on-fast as well, as against a normal, looking for FAZ with no edema. Now, this is something that we did using our inbuilt, our in-house analytic tool, and we also published it in the IOVA special issue of 2016. Where we saw the contour map across the different grades of DR, mild, moderate, severe, and proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And we saw the vessel density and the spacing was similar in both the layers. FAZ also did not significantly change, but what we saw was that in severe NPDR and PDR, they had higher spacing between the large vessels, whereas in mild NPDR, the spacing was higher between the smaller vessels. So if you look at the DME across the different slabs of octa and compare it with the on-fast, this is how you're seeing it in the outer retina. And this is the deep DCP, and you can see it's so well compared. We don't tend to see the on-fast that often, but it is definitely helpful. And this is the superficial plexus. Now going over to the retinal vein occlusions, it helps us in assessing the vasculature, the macula, and also delineating the sectoral involvement. Diagnosis of macular ischemia is quite easy, which is very common in these patients, capillary dropout also. Again, we can quantify using the analytical tool into flow and non-flow areas. So this is a patient where you can see, the area of non-perfusion on the dye-based angiography and subsequently laser was done. And if you compare it with the octa also, you can see how well the non-perfusion area is delineated in a non-invasive fashion. This is another patient, again, the superficial and the deep, and you can see the capillary dropout areas. Now, another thing that one must remember in patients with edema is that it can obscure the vasculature. It does not necessarily mean that there's loss of vasculature. And you can see that the vessels are now seen quite well after injection once the edema started resolving. So we need to be clear here that not everything that's not seen is actually absent. With resolution of the edema, the vasculature could be seen back again, improving the prognosis. So this is a patient with fresh vein occlusion as against a resolving vein occlusion. You can see the tortuosity, the dilatation of the vessels very well, and also resolution of the edema with respect with the treatment and given some time for resolution. Patients with BRV on macular ischemia are so well delineated on Octa and very comparable with the dye-based angiography. And you can again, like I said, map out the area of non-perfusion. But because of edema in fresh CRVO, sometimes the vasculature may not be visualized as seen in this Octa. So we do get a lot of artifacts, poor fixation because the vision is so low. So retinal involvement, but can be seen across all the different layers. So coming to future directions, yes, like I mentioned before, the field of view is rather small, so montage will help, and a larger scan area would be required. And this is one of the devices that has good scan and gives good montages as well. This is a swept source Octa platform, where you can also see, vitreous to sclera, very, very good resolution in the B-scans. And 3 to 6 to 8, what we were seeing has now gone on to, 12 by 12 scans. And once these are montaged, we're able to see very good images. This is by Phil Rosenfield. I borrowed these images where you can see, the montage is so clearly showing what was thought to be an NPDR patient having dropout and neovascularization, which resolved with treatment. These are some of the other platforms that are available, the Zeiss, the Topcon, and the NIDEC. I'm sure others have experience with these. To conclude, Octa is a non-invasive, repeatable diagnostic modality for retinal vascular disease. It does become extremely invaluable in understanding more than anything else, the disease pathology, the morphology. We can monitor the pathology's progression and the response to treatment. And it adds to our angiographic understanding of retinal conditions so much more. Thank you so much for this opportunity, Zia.